Hello, Nana here. Welcome back to Grim Dawn. We are playing on hardcore with our Drain Essence at Death Knight. And today we're gonna do the hidden path. We just took down the Loghorian. And before, nothing happened. Now, of course, with the Ashes of Melmoth expansion, there's this really big Aether Abomination that is in town. And apparently, if you walk up to it... Yeah, that doesn't appear on normal. On higher difficulties, at least on ultimate difficulty, I know, if you walk up to here, then you'll find a Sadima's Memento. I think it's an amulet. I picked one up with my commando when I loaded that one up. I can actually show it. That is... Where is that green thing? Oh, come on. If you're looking for something... There it is. Sadina's Memento. It's a rare amulet. Level 84, because my character was 84 or 85 at the time. Apparently this is part of some quest chain later on. So now if you find it, it is useful to hang onto it. So last episode we found ourselves a Wendigo mane and leggings. I did some digging in my stash and I managed to find another couple of useful items for level 50. Not 7 levels away, but still nice to prepare a bit. So a Death Omen, one-handed mace, boosts to vitality damage and decay. On par with what our old weapon did. I actually started using one of the weapons that we found in our Loghorian run. The green weapon, it actually boosts our ether damage rather than our vitality and decay. Nets, it is actually lost a little bit of damage there, but the fun thing is we boosted our ether damage. Drain Essence does a lot of ether damage for the actual hit, and we convert quite some of the vitality to ether as well. So boosting ether meant that per hit we do more per hit damage, but the vitality decay debuff is weaker. But the net effect is that even though we will be doing less damage overall, we will be leeching more because the amount of damage that can be leeched from is actually a little higher. But the reason I picked it up is because we now have a Howling Wind proc that has a forms an aura around me that does cold damage. And it has a chance of freezing enemies. It's going to be up 6 out of 20 seconds. So at the beginning of a fight, I'll have it when it's most useful. So that's going to be pretty decent. Now, if it doesn't work out, I still have the old dagger in my backpack here. We can switch to it at any time. But level 50, I'm thinking of putting on a Death Omen if we don't find anything better by that time. Now, we boost our damage a bit. We get some leech with... all the weapon damage component attacks, some fist to vitality damage conversion, bit of health, bit of attack speed, and 100% chance when I get hit to cast Mark of Death. 2 second recharge, so effectively this one is going to be rapid firing a lot. 5 second duration, nearly 600 points of vitality damage, which will be buffed quite a bit by equipping this, because this item itself boosts vitality damage, whereas the current one does not. So by that time, it's probably going to be hit for 700 vitality. 20% reduction to enemies' health. That is pretty substantial against weaker mobs. It's not going to be all that useful against stronger mobs. But still, it's going to be fun. 100 reduced defensive ability means I'm going to hit and crit more often. And 20% reduced total speed. That's also quite significant. Makes enemies move slower, but also attack and cast slower. So... I think in boss fight this might actually give us quite a defensive edge. As I said, until we have something that might even be better. Such as something... like I think the Spirit Crush. It's a blue mace that reduces enemies' attack speed as well as their resistances. And also the enhanced version of that gives +1 to all necro skills, which is pretty nice. Some runic bracers at level 50. Lots of resists, pretty decent armor. It's a pretty simple choice. For the shoulders, a lot of armor, a lot of resists, bunch of health. Again, pretty nice. If you might have spotted the trend, I like my defensive options. And a Warpath Girdle is something I found. +1 to all skills in Soldier. As well as a little bonus to offensive ability and crit damage. Might be useful. We're getting quite some defensive procs from the and defensive passives from the Soldier side. So +1 in all of them might help a little bit. So the Seer in town is dead. Gave her life defending town against the Abomination here. So we'll have to do without. So let's get started with the hidden path. Well, of course, that's what I started with, but seeing that Abomination sparked off all kinds of other things. So we're still here on the Veteran. These mobs though absolutely don't scale along. But we are looking for the entrance into the hidden path, which is somewhere along the sides here. There it is. Actually took the opportunity to walk here from town for a change. Most of the time, I do not do that. 2 dynamite. Oh, that is lucky. I think that is exactly the amount of dynamite I have left. And then there are some rift scourges here. Lots of poison. I'm resisting most damage types pretty well. Chaos is actually my weakest with only 61% resist. So I think we're gonna do pretty well here. Though of course, those are famous last words. So kill the Razorback. There's already another Rotbite just waiting there to murder me. And it goes down without too much trouble. And look, another one. Ravacrix the Ravenous. Well, your poison does not scare me. I can leech. But I do like the gameplay where there's just lots and lots of heroes swarming me at all times. That is one of the nice things about Elite and eventually Ultimate. Many more higher tier enemies that, well, actually pose a challenge. I mean, every once in a while having to make a strategic withdrawal is pretty nice. So this is from the weapon, the nice and blue swirly that you're seeing here. And we found ourselves the first Guardian, the Guardian of Drieg. So this one does lots of poison damage. It seems to sunder armor. But doing all right here. And there we are. One down, 2 more to go. Ooh, we have a Mad Queen to take care of as well. Or to be taken care of by the Mad Queen. It depends on how it's going to work out. Ooh, hello buggies. Goodbye buggies. But yeah, Mad Queen, fun stuff. Ooh, Boot of Tormented Souls. The of Tormented Souls rare suffix. Here it boosts my Fatality and Aether damage. Or I've seen it on belts and on amulets that it actually also gives you +1 to your Drain Essence skill. So that is useful. Here it does not. So that's a runestone for the hidden path content. And that grants us access to the next one. So that's going to be in the Broken Hills. It took me quite a while to get a natural understanding of the layout of the map to actually know where to go without having to look up or to stumble around a lot for the hidden path. But only took me like 5 or 6 actual runs. Enemies here, they scale up almost to where we are. They're now level 41, that's 2 below me. So they're not quite there, just pushing a little beyond the level that is supported by the area. But still, no, 40. Not too bad in terms of XP gain, things like that. And the bosses are going to be relatively doable. Oh, hello there, Harpy. Let's see. They are, of course, oh, look at that. 3 different heroes. So we'll just Mark of Torments the one here. It is electrified, that one is swift. Well, it's swift to die as well. And then the other one, I couldn't even read what it was because it was dead as well. We got some XP. We got some faction reputation. But Homestead, life is pretty good. Also, I actually overshot my destination a little bit, but well, killing three heroes, that does make up for quite a bit of it. Because we actually need to head down here. So we need to be in the bottom left side of the big, big bend here. And then once we find that, we can push aside a very large rock. That one, to be precise. So in terms of map orientation, the Steps of Torment are over there. The road down here, it extends further and it's in a bend over here. So that's pretty pretty easy to find. And now it's gonna be the Guardian of Solal, I think. Ooh, you are a regenerator. Keep in mind, regenerators are, well, they regenerate life. If you use Siphon Souls against them, you reduce the life regeneration that they have, effectively making them much easier to deal with. And having the mutator active, called Seer Souls for Siphon Souls, means the debuff is going to be active for 9 seconds rather than for only 3, making it a lot easier to deal with. Okay, so this one has the potential to do quite some damage. Let's actually drain Essence rather than Blitz. Yeah, see, wow, that's a lot of damage. Maybe I should not stand in the nice purple cloud. Yeah, purple's a nice color, but to be standing in it, taking a lot of damage, might not be the best of plans here. And that gets us another runestone. Also, we scored some Solal Sect Leg Guards. The Guardians have a set of monster in frequency for pants. Each has a different one. They're considered to be among the best in the game. In this case though, they don't have a lot of armor. Though the resist, it's ether, elemental and bleeding resist. That is pretty nice. The damage is a bit of a mismatch, but not too shabby. But it's level 35, right? Yeah, see, level 35 pants. That's a bit low level. So next up, we're gonna go into the snow, and if I remember, it was the Astakhan Road. Yeah, it was the one with the bridge up here. And this is gonna be the exciting one, because this is where, on the one hand, we have the Guardian of Bismio. I think it was Bismio. But this is also where the Mad Queen lives. And I'm gonna face down the Mad Queen. And I'm gonna actually face down the Mad Queen in all three difficulties. So that's gonna be interesting, especially the ultimate version. It's definitely a tough challenge. She's got some reflection stuff going on that might be painful. But oh, it's part of the hidden path, and it's the hidden content in the hidden path, so kind of obligated to do it. At least now that I know about the content, I think I should do it. And so far, I think with the exception of my Inquisitor, all of my characters have managed to murder. Well, the Inquisitor did, but he did die along the way, but Inquisitor was very much not a tanky character. And I play best when I play with tanky characters. And this one, I think it qualified as tanky. I mean, we could effectively face tank the Loghorian, with a small exception of when he had a lot of, when he had two unique buddies tagging along. So I think we'll be fine. So another door that requires one of the stones. And we are now in secret territory. So we got some summons. Some summonses. There we go, underneath the bridge. Walk aside, get some summonses. Oh, come on. Don't be slowpokes. Be murdered. Thank you. And then there is a crumbling wall that leads into our inside. So the arena here is roughly O-shaped, circle-shaped, whatever you want to call it. On the left-hand side, Guardian of Bismiel. Top side, secret door to the Mad Queen. There's no danger of accidentally triggering the Mad Queen. In fact, I played at least half a dozen characters passed here without ever actually realizing there was a secret. I really needed to be pointed towards it. He's a guardian. So this one is much more lightning-y. Luckily, we are resisting lightning at the max, so that's pretty good. I think the breath counts as a spell, since my energy seems to be filling up a little bit. I think I do have some components that actually grant me some energy whenever someone uses a spell at me. More lore, more stones, and an attribute point for defeating the three guardians. But of course, it's not just about the guardians. It is, in fact, all about the temple, which of course is in the East Marsh. But first, over here is a shiny loose rock that opens up the doorway. If this were standard, I would open up. Oh, I put down a portal here just to get resurrected here in case it happens. On hardcore, that portal is gonna be utterly useless. So here goes, wish me luck. The Mad Queen. Luckily we have a lot of life leech, and I think I'll just step outside of the poison. Put down some overguard here. Okay, she is she's yelling a lot. And she does a decent amount of damage when she charges. Okay, so Mark of Torment is up. Let's put an overguard up here. And so far I haven't actually used my overguard. I like to keep it as a panic button, similar with health potions. Let's get out of there. And she died. Ding dong, the queen is dead. Long live the queen. Or something along those lines. Not quite sure if it kind of applies there. Well, playing a few more characters, so we're now the Mad Queen, I guess. I don't know. Is that title hereditary? And we got ourselves a fortified tower shield for the effort. But we survived. That's of course the number one criteria for all the fights. If you survive, it was a good fight. Is there any loot here? Seem to remember there being treasure chests in the back in earlier fights. Okay. Well, so much for that plan. No loot for me. How much crap do I have? 15. I think 15 is enough. I think you only needed 10 to get to the East Marsh. So let's do that. The next stage in our journey. We take Burwich Village. We take the path to the bottom right. It's low level ethereals here. They don't even give you any reputation with the factions because they're low level. Much too low level to be worth anything, but they are kind of annoying. They stand in the way, and it's not the scrap that's the problem, it is the dynamite. But we can craft dynamite in Homestead, we can. So we'll just quickly pop up and down to town. I mean, these are very real things that you could run into if you were doing it yourself. So this is just for, let's say this is for demonstration purposes. So we craft ourselves dynamite, get three whole sticks. You know what, I'll just do it three times just to make sure I have enough. Well, we are here. I might as well just put some of the components away. Like that. And then remember, we have a portal open out in the wild, so you don't want to be lazy and portal from town. You actually want to walk over here. And then use this one. Whole reason this one is gated behind dynamite is so you don't do it too early. So we clear it. 8,000 bits, 10 scrap. Well, we don't have that. And then we can run along. So the East Marsh is a relatively large area. All the way in the top right is where we need to be for the devotion shrine. There's also a boss that needs to be killed for the outcasts. In the middle, in the top, or in the bend actually, there is the entrance to the Temple of the Three. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna tag along the bottom of the map, have pick some fights with the local troll population. They really don't like intruders. With a bit of luck, we'll get to face down a couple of unique trolls, or at least at the very least some heroes. Level 47, they are not messing around. I think the boss might actually be 48 or 49. Would be nice if if the boss is actually 50. No, 48. Well, it's just a random rare. Oh, 50 is of course the level for legendary item drops. I wouldn't mind getting some legendary item drops. On the other hand, no, as long as they're your level or higher, you're gonna get full XP. You're gonna get a lot of XP, and you'll be leveling quite a lot. So we'll be getting into the level range where legendaries start dropping from heroes soon enough. Okay, this is a big camp. This is often where some kind of interesting trolls live. I said as there were no... see, the Swamp King, level 48. So, Mark of Torment on the Swamp King, so whatever someone does, Swamp King is gonna get paid for it. Technically, Mark of Torment plus Overguard is a combo, because Mark of Torment gives you damage absorption, and based on your damage absorption, you reflect damage to enemies. Overguard also gives you damage absorption, so no, they want to combo that way. But to be honest, I tend to use the Mark of Torment more as an offensive thing that just happens to have some defensive properties. And I really keep my Overguard as a lifesaver button rather than something that I'm regularly triggering. But if you're less paranoid about staying alive, there is a combo there that might be useful. It might be good to be aware of that it exists at least. It's nice the swirl around you. It seems like every time the swirl applies, there's damage, but there's also a 33% chance for enemies to get frozen. And if they don't get frozen on the first tick, then of course there is another and another and another tick to see if they can get frozen. Okay, we're going through this pretty quickly. This is where the power level of a build like this with we have a lot of sustain. We are doing a decent chunk of damage. Could always be better, of course, but I do like the damage versus energy management of where we are at now. Okay, there's some green stuff swirling about. Doesn't really do me much in terms of damage. I'm happy for that. And we gained a level. So, next goal is Harbinger of Souls. So, let's just put 3 points in the bar. So, that's gonna be 3 more levels. Yeah, then we put just 1 point in it. And after that, I'm gonna switch over to the Soldier and push this one. Try at least get Warcry, probably with Terrify on top, before level 50. because it gets pretty tedious pushing mastery bars after 50. And now putting more points into skills that you already have is pretty nice. Because then it, no, you're just improving something rather than waiting for something to happen. Goodbye. Have a nice sleepy time. I triggered a rock, but I saw Grubbles. They need to die. When they even have a hero in here. Puke's not the unwashed. Yeah, you definitely need a bath. I'll bathe you in blood. Aren't I considerate? I think the opinions might differ. People in Homestead are gonna find me incredibly considerate. Grobles, probably less so. And there we have Kaliska, the Bone Hunter, level 49. Basically because it's 5 levels above me. Some of the more challenging areas might even be 6 or 7 levels above you, but 5 is also pretty good still. Oh, we have a spirit point to spend. And we got ourselves a Fang of the Bone Hunter, and the witch wants that one. The witch in Fort Icon, a rotten corpse. I wonder what loot you have. Not a lot, just one component. One a chipped claw and one a devotion point. While the loot drops, we'll spend it and we're gonna get some vitality resistance. Overcaps us, so that's good. What was that? Okay, just a small pile. Okay, so we will just continue the... Hey, is there a staircase there? There's a staircase there. Yes. Ooh, now I know what I was confused with the if you remember in the Inquisitor playthrough near the end in the harbor, the Black Harbor, in the Malwolf Harbor district, there all the way in the top of the harbor, there's also a small island that's next to where the one of the final quest things lies. And I was thinking, I'm expecting here to be a small island that you can reach after something that is sort of kind of already a secret. Well, I was confusing it with this, because this is also a pretty well hidden. No, again, no, they are using the terrain as camouflage. If you're looking at it from another angle, then of course it is much more obvious. Which is why, you know, just spinning the wheel on the compass sometimes helps. Because it gives you literally a different perspective on the game. And it will help to reveal some optically hidden secrets. So what was my character doing? Some undead here, that's always lovely. It is an ambush. And Uruburg's journal. And we found Squire's boot blueprints. Some low level boots. That's alright. Anything fun over here? Nope. Oh, more stuff popping out of the floor. That is fun. They are a couple levels above me as well, so that's good for the XP. Would be nicer actually if there were ghosts popping out. Not that I'm complaining about enemies, but well, ghosts do have a chance of dropping an upgraded version of this. I know there is one at level, well, I'm wearing the level 32 base right now. I know there's another base that spawns from 52 going forward, but I'm not sure if there's one that's aimed at the level 40s. That would be potentially an upgrade for me as well. Otherwise, I'll just have to be a little bit patient and find it around 50. Okay. So the map is roughly U-shaped if you apply a little bit of fantasy to it. Here, mostly at the bottom here, there's a stone hidden. I think this was it. Am I misjudging that one? Ah, there's a stone, and this one is actually clickable. We have all the hidden path stones, so of course we can move through. And this gets us to the Temple of the Unseen. Temple of the Three, duh. They are the three gods, so it is the Temple of the Three. It's pretty simple that way. So, mobs here are only two levels above me. Wonder if that was different inside. Oh, these are three above me. I think most of the time I'm relatively low level right now. I think most of my characters are 44, 45, 46 when they defeated the Loghorian. So 46, 47 by the time they get here. So a bit lower level. I think most of the time the big end boss is in the low 50s, no, 50, 51, 52. And then of course there's a chance for it to drop legendaries. So maybe sneaking in one more level while killing all the things on the way there would be incredibly convenient. But if that's not the case, I'm not gonna go out of my way to farm other areas to be 50 or to be a couple levels higher. But you can wish. You can wish. Okay, there's some. Hello there. Level 48. So the heroes are four levels above me here. That's good to keep in mind. The obstacles in here are gonna be randomly placed. But now the general aim is to just move from left to right along the way. Trying to trigger as many traps with monster spawns. Such as this. Hello there. Okay, is there any place in this room that does not have poison on it? Oh, you sneaky plague swarm. Just sneaking up on me. Ooh, 49. Nice. That's five levels above me. There's hope for me yet. And, ooh, aha, ornate strongbox. I overlooked that, but the boss fight just put some more attention on the area here. Ooh, a book. And some circles on the floor. Usually circles mean spawn camps. Using your blitz to extract yourself from some poisonous surface areas. Pretty good strategy. And then I'm just gonna go. Ooh, hello there. This could have been a spawn camp, but it was not. Anytime there's circles on the floor, that's no. It's like a bullseye. And then we have a dead end. And a small treasure box up here. I'm not gonna do a 100% full clear. Well, 75% clear is gonna be fine enough for me. I'm just gonna try to hit the larger rooms, try to trigger as many of the obvious, maybe not so obvious traps, with no spawn traps that is. Because of course that's gonna get me a lot of experience and potential for loot drops and a treasure. Some enemies down there. They're a little out of the way. Okay, you guys are shooting at me from all angles, and there is, ooh, level 49. Electrified Elcrix. Not so electrified anymore. And then let's enter the room. There's a treasure here. Obviously, that must be trapped. Eldritch life drinkers. And another spawn here. Some lore. They were popping out of the floor, and I've got a lot of passive defenses, so I wasn't really all that worried here. Okay, so let's take the effort of going a bit through the wing here. It's most of the time, I remember this as not being the most interesting of wings. No, there's a couple of spawns, but there's no real boss fights, no real big treasure. But it's good to double check that every once in a while. Okay, there's no secrets there. No, making sure. And we came from there. Okay, cool. Through here, through there. And then we smash it. Cool. Another circle. And no traps. Okay. Okay, we eventually have to end up on the right side, but well, this does look tempting. Lots of things popping up, no real opportunity to do damage to me. This is also an opportunity to acquaint yourself with the local wildlife. The boss is gonna summon some of those, if I remember correctly. Yeah, or at least there's gonna be some spawns. It might not actually be summons, it's just gonna be location-based spawns. These hellhounds, they explode for fire damage. So if you get your resistances up, that's good. Not getting hit, even better. So no, kite away a little bit, shoot them from range. No, the explosion isn't too large, so you do have the luxury of just taking a couple steps and then finishing them off, or no, tagging them and then running away, where your damage over time abilities finish the job for you. If you go in here and your poison resist are not maxed, you're probably gonna have a not entirely fun time, since there, as you've seen, there is a lot of poison damage here. But nope, this lightning damage from the spiders, that is not pleasant either. And the explosions, they are fire. And yes, I know, I'm not maxed out on fire. But no, as I mentioned before, with some careful gameplay, you can work around some of those limitations. And we're getting closer and closer to the final fight. It's gonna be a portcullis any time soon now. Life drinker, that looks very lightning, chaos, something. Though lifesteal is usually vitality based. Hello there. Small treasure. No, it is a trap. Giant's blood, rank 7. That is always nice. No, getting your abilities upgraded just before a boss fight means they are at their very best. Another small treasure. And no trap. That is interesting. And this is the entrance to the fight. Let's do this. This one is gonna do lots of damage over time abilities if we can avoid moving around for too much. Also, let's actually use Drain Essence rather than Blitz. And he is indeed 6 levels above me. So he is 50 rather than what the others were at 49. So he just does not have the damage capability of getting through my lifesteal from Drain Essence. And he actually went down surprisingly quick. I've had longer fights with him. And we got ourselves a Eldritch Keeper's Cask. Chaos bleed damage, some health, some poison resist, and a bit of cooldown reduction on a helmet. That is pretty rare. That's usually an offhand property. And a Templar's Faith, level 50, heavy resistance and block chance shield. It's pretty neat if you are not really interested in a very specific kind of shield. So I'm gonna pass this one up. So over here, oh, we see, this is the reason why you don't really wanna run around too much, because then you get add-ons, and there's actually some heroic add-ons here that are doing more damage than the boss. That is kind of funny in its own way. Just to complete this, see if there's anything else we can win out. Let's just go through all the corners of the arena. Okay, some spawns, but just regular mobs. And that was it. So these were the most dangerous ones. Another treasure chest. That's always nice. Another treasure chest. Then there's a secret, well, kind of obvious from the side, with some exploding hounds, so be careful. And that is more items. And then down here, I don't think we could go. Nope, blocked off. Okay, so let's have a chat with the person stuck in a rock. I have come to learn of the witch gods. How do I learn from the tree? I am ready to receive this gift. Yoo-hoo, one skill point. Search power. I need a moment. That's a polite way to just say thank you, bye. We'll just keep advancing our mastery here. Only 6 more points to Harbinger of Souls. And that completed the hidden path. So I'm gonna thank you very much for watching. And I hope you will join me again next time as we start on the expansion content. Bye bye.